Thank you.
Good, you don't.
Thanks, Joe. It's 12 minutes, almost 11 minutes before 8. Paul McCartney, after these words.
Someone knocking at the door. Somebody ringing the bell. Someone's knocking at the door. Somebody's ringing the bell. Do me a favor. Open the door. And let him in. Ooh, yeah.
And if she's beside me, I know I need never care. But to love her is to lead her everywhere.
For over 29 before 9 right now, 9 before 8 right now, for over 20 years now, Paul McCartney has been making music first with and then without the Beatles. Critics have sometimes made some unfavorable comparisons to his more recent work, but in the new movie, Give My Regards to Broad Street, Paul mixes McCartney and Beatles tunes side by side. And this morning, the first part of my four-part interview with Paul McCartney, he talks about how this mix, this movie, came to be.
It was a kind of basic thing. It was basically an entertainment thing rather than a kind of deep, structured, you know, thing. It was really just to kind of create a pleasant evening out for people.
All right, you've strung together, in a sense, a lot of your, you know, great hit songs, and you perform them, and at the same time, new songs you've written, and you perform those, and you put them together on the screen. Why? What was the idea behind that? The old and the new.
Oh, the old and the new. That was the director.
But you wrote it, so I mean, you were in control of it.
No, what I did was, when I wrote the script, I wrote opportunities for music to happen. I kind of said, comes into room and sits down and then sings music three.
Yeah.
So I didn't actually sort of choose the songs there. I just left them open. I left it to him being the director, and I kind of said, what do you fancy here? And he'd say, well, you know, we're at a film studio at this point in the thing. I'd really like to do a big production number here. And I've got my eye on such and such a song. Can we do that one?
Right.
So, for instance, that particular thing, he chose a song called Ballroom Dancing.
Ballroom Dancing.
I gave him a list of about 50 songs. I said, you know, I've written one or two, but these are like the 50 that I'd be happy right now to sing. Either I haven't sung them for a long time, or I'm kind of rediscovering them, or I took a look at the words of that and it seemed quite nice. So I gave him ones that I was up for singing, and then said, well, you know, you can kind of choose according to your various reasons. Some of the reasons were for plot reasons.
Right.
I do Yesterday in it, and I said to him, I'm really going to do that again, am I, you know, good old favorite? And he said, well, you know, people want to hear it. And he said, but in the script, there's a plot reason.
Was the original title of that song really Scrambled Eggs?
Baby, How I Love Your Legs.
How much of that do you remember? I was shocked when I was Scrambled Eggs.
Scrambled Eggs. Baby, how I love your legs. I believe in Scrambled Eggs. That's what it
really?
Was, yeah. Well, because
really?
I didn't have any lyrics, in truth, yeah. That's that one. But what happened was I just... some songs, they come so easily that they fool you. You think you mustn't have written it. And with Yesterday, I'd been asleep, and I kind of woke up, and I almost fell out of bed, and there was a piano by my bed. And I just had this tune in my head. Started writing it on the piano, and I started playing the chords, and I thought, I haven't written this. I've just dreamt it and someone else has written. So I went around for about 3 weeks before I dared put any lyrics to it, asking people, say, where have you heard this before? They said, I haven't, but it's quite a nice tune. I said, no, come on, you know, we must have heard it before. I've heard it before. And when I found out it wasn't, then I put some lyrics on it.
Yesterday, all my troubles seem so far away. Oh, they're here to stay. Oh, I believe in yesterday.
Are the best songs that you have written the ones that came out like that, or are there some good ones that you really had to sweat over?
I think maybe the best ones come out like that, because they just drop out, you know.
Oh, I believe in yesterday.
Where did Rick? Rigby come from? Where did that, how did that come about?
I was in Bristol, wandering around the town, and I saw a shop called Rigby's. And I've always been one, I like names. I like what names do. You know, they suggest something about the person. And I put Eleanor with it and then dreamed up this idea of the, of a kind of lonely old spinster whose face was in the jar by the door, and it wasn't going to work out for her, and it was a kind of a sort of lonely, sad thing.
Eleanor Rigby picks up the rice in the church where her wedding has been. Lives in a dream, waits at the window, wearing the face that she keeps in a jar by the door. Who is it for? All the lonely people. Where do they all come from? All the lonely people. Where do they all belong?
More with Paul McCartney tomorrow and early next week.
Paul McCartney remembers John Lennon right after this.
So many haunting songs that have become standards now. Some of those songs are recalled in the new movie, Give My Regards to Broad Street. Today, in the second part of my interview with Paul McCartney, he talks about his feelings about John Lennon and John's widow, Yoko Ono, about how his songwriting has changed through the years, about how Ringo, George, and John and the early days together.
Hey Jude, don't make it bad. Take a sad song.
I think that probably this, my work then was kind of coming out easier. It was easier to work for me because it was more novel. I was working with a guy called John Lennon too, who let us not forget. And he's one smart cookie, that boy. So it was very much easier. It was kind of, it was twice as easy as it is now to write with John, because I would come up with a kind of dumb line and he would just say, that's a dumb line. You know, and I'd do the same with him. That was really our strength. I remember I had a line which was, she was just 17. She'd never been a beauty queen. That was my line. Okay, and he went, big elbow for that. And so we worked a little harder and we got to. Hotel to gig.
What about John? I know you're quoted as saying that the relationship you had with him when he died wasn't as good as you would like it to have been. Mm-hmm. How have you come to terms with all of that?
Well, I haven't really. I don't think you do really. Round about, I think it was about 69 or something, the group, the Beatles, just broke up and we got into a lot of business disarray, and there were various people really on our case, you know, from kind of, because there's a lot of money knocking around and we didn't have it organized at all. So we got into a lot of business hassles, as I think a lot of people know, and that hurt our friendships because then we started to sort of split apart. But the one consolation for me was that although for the last 10 years of John's life we hadn't really been tight, and in fact we'd had a lot of these business hassles, the great thing was that the very last phone call I happened to make with him, I happened to speak with him, we didn't talk one bit about business. It was all just about family. It was about kids. It was really warm, and it was fabulous. It was like the best phone conversation of the whole 10 years. So, I mean, I thank heaven for small mercies, really.
What about Yoko? Do you see her? Do you talk with her? Are you?
A little bit, you know. I don't really know her too well. I didn't know her too well at the time. No. John was the one who knew Yoko, really. You know, that it was John's, she was John's lady and love. And we had to respect that. I think at first we had a lot of problem because it was breaking up the old gang, you know, Wedding Bells, breaking that old gang of mine. And but you can't say to two people who are in love, listen, the Beatles is more important than your love. And we were all aware that we couldn't say that. She's a nice lady, you know, but I never did get on that well, kind of thing. So I think it's a kind of fake to just saying, oh, she's great, we really get on, we really chat and stuff. She's good, you know, but I think we don't see eye to eye on something.
Filling out the Beatles thing, George. How is George? Do you see George? What's George doing?
George is wonderful. He's fine. George does a lot of film stuff. He produces films. He is to do with films like Time Bandits and stuff like that. Mm.
Ringo.
Ringo is Ringo.
What does that mean?
So you tell me.
You're the one that's supposed to know.
Yeah, no, Ringo's just always been exactly the same as he ever sort of was, except he's kind of learned a bit more through the years about, well, I don't know, you're kind of eating in French restaurants and that kind of thing that you do learn, you know. But basically, he's just the same guy he ever was, you know. Ringo is just a head case. He's great, though. I mean, don't take that the wrong way. He's a great fella.
Do you envision writing with it? Do you write with anybody else now?
Yeah, occasionally. But I mean, I don't think I'd try and get a collaborator in the same way as John and I kind of hooked up. Because it would be really looking for the Holy Grail, you know. It's not easy. It wouldn't be easy for anyone else to fill his shoes either, you know.
Paul McCartney, more with Paul next week. And it's 5 Up. We'll be right back.
In a moment, David's conversation with Paul and Linda McCartney right after this.
With many songwriters, the music of Paul McCartney often seems to be drawn from his personal life. There are such personal songs in his new movie, It's Give My Regards to Broad Street. In my recent conversation with Paul and with his wife, Linda McCartney, we talked about family, we talked about children, the other aspects of his life outside the music.
One, two, three, four.
I had a very strong background. My dad was, there were 7 kids in his family. So when they all got married, that was 14. They had kids, that was 28 or whatever, you know. And they multiplied like rabbits pretty soon. So I've got this huge family in Liverpool, which nearest I can mention is like an Italian family or something. I mean, it's a Liverpool kind of family. It's a very working class family. Come on, son, have a cup of tea. What's wrong, son? And all this kind of thing. There's a great strength. There's a great working class strength there. That I still draw on.
They always make a joke. They always make you feel at home. And I think that's in him now. I think he's like that. And he doesn't think of himself as this big time Charlie. You know, he writes music is the way he looks at it. He likes to sing.
Linda, what was it about Linda that caught your eye and your heart?
First of all, it was just her looks. We met actually in a club, nightclub. And I thought, do 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 do. I like her. So I started to chat with her and stuff. But I'd met many people in nightclubs and started to chat then. What was different from Linda was she was a woman. Strangely enough, I mean, she was the first sort of woman I'd ever gone out with. She was actually divorced at the time and was having to look after a kid in New York on her own. And she was a very spunky woman, so I was kind of attracted to that. I thought, my God, she's got it together, you know. And most other girls, you kind of just go out and you wine them and dine them and it's, thank you. But she had something more going. And then the other basic thing beyond that was she's very kind. She's got a massive heart.
A lot of people said it'll never last. And it's 15, 16 years?
15, 16 years. Yeah, I mean, I think there were times when we might have agreed with them, you know, because, you know, it's not easy.
We've gone this far. We're good friends. I think friendship's important.
How do you do that? How do you live a normal life? I mean, you're worth hundreds of millions of dollars. How do you do it, Paul? You know what I'm saying.
Yeah, I mean, there you live on the farm. Yeah, I don't really know, you know. I just think, it sounds big-headed. I think I'm sensible about it. I don't mean it too big-headed. I mean it in this family thing. If they'd have done this, what I would have done, they would have made sure that they kept their feet on the ground, that they looked for what the priorities were, that they did the insane stuff, but took a little look to see if it was really insane, and then if it was, withdraw from it a little bit.
We haven't got all those millions that everybody talks about. I mean, okay, Beatle Records and Paul's solo records make a lot of money, but the record company, everybody gets a fair share.
See, for instance, like with money, my dad, always said don't borrow and don't bet on the horses either, because you know he'd lost the packet to him when he was a kid, so he'd give me all these little bits of advice, some of which I took.
What's a good day for you? I mean, what's a perfect day? How do you spend your time?
For me, I could get up in the morning, do a little bit of sort of physical, because I've never been physical at all. I was never
not a jock,
never any kind of a jock, so now it's really interesting to sort of, you know, do that.
How are you at it?
Not very good, but I think I'm terrific. I love it.
Good day, sunshine. Good day, sunshine.
Then I might work a little bit with song, go for a ride on a horse, play with the kids, mainly. That's the main entertainment.
You really do spend a lot of time.
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, but it's funny, you know, when you say that, it seems like you just clocked up 10 brownie points. But I really like them. I mean, I'm not clocking up any points. I really like them. I really enjoy their company a lot.
How has Paul grown in these years you've known him?
I think he's mellowed out a bit. I think he's experienced life more.
I mean, I've looked at my life. In the middle of the 60s, I wasn't a family man. I was a bachelor gay in London, going to the clubs every night, music and clubs, and a bit more drink and yo-ho.
You're quoted as saying you sowed a lot of wild oats in those days.
Not me, mate. No, it was him. Yeah, you know, I mean, I had a fun time, you know, like you probably did too. You were just not owning up. All right? But
Four minutes of eight right now, Paul McCartney. We'll be back after this.
In our next hour, Raquel Welch and Janet Leigh. But with Paul McCartney, he will answer his critics right after this.
Eleanor Rigby picks up the rice in the church where a wedding has been. Lives in a dream, waits at the window, wearing the face that she keeps in a jar by. I feel good in a special way. I'm in love and it's a sunny day. Good day, sunshine.
Minutes before eight right now. In the last part of my conversation with Paul McCartney, he talks about past and present collaborations.
Ebony and ivory live together in perfect harmony.
The truth is, when you kind of have a success like the Beatles, it is very difficult to follow.
And then when the Beatles broke up, Paul was at loose ends, you know, he didn't know really what to do with himself, so he said, let's start a group.
You can't take a song like Yesterday or Eleanor Rigby and say, is it any better than what we're writing today? Only history can tell you that.
And you tend to believe the critics. You tend to think, of course, nothing I'm doing now is as good. It never will be.
Paul McCartney, the world's greatest songwriter, singing with some girl who doesn't sing. So, and in that way, they were right, but I was up there to have fun. And, I mean, I sang in tune. Everybody sang, I sang out of tune. But the funny thing is, a lot of the music I like is that tiny bit out of tune. I mean, I like a lot of the new groups who do sing that tiny bit flat, but it appeals to me. And I think the blend of very in-tune voices with a little bit of out is nice. But I tell you, I read stuff about me. I couldn't believe it.
All right, what's the biggest misconception about you? What's the biggest thing that's been written or said about you that's just really flat out wrong and rotten?
I think the press really made it sound like I was very pushy and cold. Two things I'm not at all. I'm a very warm person, I think. And I'm not pushy. You know, I didn't push myself in. In fact, I'm very shy. And I do tend to stay on the sidelines.
No one can supplant Lennon in the McCartney relationship. It was a rivalry which sparked off some of the greatest songs we've known this century. I think he would like to have someone of his standing to work with and rub up against. But there isn't anybody. Say, say, say what you want, but
don't play games with my affection. You have done videos with, what, Michael Jackson, right?
Yep.
Why?
Actually, the story was that Michael rang me Christmas Day at home, and I didn't believe it was him. Because his voice sounded high on the phone, you know. And I thought it was someone else. I said, come off it, yeah, come on, you know, pull the other one, we know. And he started laughing and he said, you don't believe it's me, do you? I said, who is this? Come on, because I was being very butch and fatherly, you know, Christmas Day. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I was being very... And, you know, so I was a phone call and I thought it was just someone pestering me. Anyway, it wasn't, it was Michael. And he said, let's get together, you know, let's do some stuff. I said, great, you know, because I'd admired him. I love his voice, his dancing, he's a big talent. So I said, you got it.
The critics are on your case, right? And perhaps they always will be. They're going to always compare.
They are always going to be on my case.
All right, why? How do you explain it?
They're like going to compare everything you do. They're on your case. You know, they're always going to be on everyone's case. Critics are critics, you know, they're there to criticize, and that's what they're going to do.
It's very difficult to put anything up against the great classics of the past, you know, because 20 years ago was different people working. I was different, certainly. And those songs were spawned of something that happened. I mean, it wasn't just Paul, it was the world around him at that time that helped in the writing of those songs.
When I do decide to stand up for myself, I start to find a lot of things over the last 10 years that I actually do think are as good as the Beatles things. But I can get easily misled into the kind of standard view of you're not as good as you were, are you, son? But I say, when I do stand up, there's songs like Band on the Run, which I think is as good as anything I ever did. I mean, I think it is very difficult to recapture past glories. So if you're just going to get sad about that, well, forget it. I mean, you know, it won't help. So I generally think, you know, I'm doing okay.
Not bad. Paul McCartney, 4 minutes before 8. We'll be right back.